book will speak about you. Your favorite subject of mine, propagation of uncertainty. Yay, I know, I never cheered. Okay. And so we want to propagate uncertainty because we'll see some examples today. The thing you measure may not be the thing you're actually interested in. Okay, that sounds absurd, but we do this all the time. We have a calibration chart. We're interested in concentration, but we measure absorbance, right? So we're measuring absorbance. We're not interested in absorbance. We're interested in concentration. So how do we get the uncertainty in absorbance to translate into uncertainty in concentration? And so that's the main focus today, is to figure out how to convert uncertainties. We know how to convert numbers, but how do we convert uncertainties and propagate them through? And it's all based on this. If you don't know how certain you are, then the number you report is useless because the person has no confidence in your number. This is about trust. And when you're communicating your results, you want to communicate your trustworthiness, how certain you are of the particular result. So directly measured quantities have easily determined uncertainties. You know, you buy a balance, it says plus or minus 0.0002 grams. It's right there on the box. Every measurement would have that, plus or minus 0.0002 grams. But what if you make a difference? You take this value and you subtract the value of the container. Now you have two weights, and your uncertainty is a little larger than 0.0002 because you've made two measurements. You've taken the mass with and without the container. And so what is it? How do you calculate the real uncertainty in your net mass? You have to propagate it. You have to go through and figure out what that larger uncertainty is. And then we also talk about the mean and standard deviation. How certain are we that the mean is going to capture the true value? So let's talk about that for a little bit. These are the equations that we had. We saw these in physical chemistry. We'll see them again today. It depends upon the type of calculation, how these uncertainties are propagated through. So if it's sums and differences, so your result y is a plus b minus c, then this is the uncertainty in y. You see, it's just the sum of the squares of the uncertainties of each of the components. And so you see this square root, this, if you could just square both sides, then you have this uncertainty squared in y. So this is a more general equation, a more general form of that. That if it's sums and differences, this sigma squared is called the variance. So the variance of your result is just the sum of the variances of all the pieces that you're subtracting or adding. Very easy to, equation to remember here. But you could take this equation and turn it into that one just as easily. Now what do you see on this one for products and quotients? So A, B divided by C. You see the individual components, but what are these terms here? These are relative standard deviations. So this is the average value for B, and this is the uncertainty in B. And so you've got the standard deviation divided by the mean. You've got the relative standard deviation right here for component B, the relative standard deviation for component C, the relative standard deviation for component A. So Y is made up of components A, B, and C. In this case, they're multiplied and divided. So when it's multiplication and division, you take the relative standard deviation for each of those components. You square it, add them all together, and then you can take the square root and get the relative standard deviation for your result, Y. So this is essentially the same equation, only instead of the variance, it's the RSD. So the RSD of your result squared is equal to the sum of the RSDs of all your components squared. Very simple equation to remember and use. So if you can solve this equation, then you can get to that. You can get to the uncertainty in Y. That's why I say going from RSD to Y, or from an uncertainty and a mean value to the RSD, has to be automatic for you. You have to be able to, if I give you the RSD for a component and I tell you what the mean value is, you should be able to get to the uncertainty. But given any two of those three things, you should be able to get the other very easily. So if I give you these two, you calculate the RSD. If I give you the RSD and Y, you calculate this. If I give you the RSD and the uncertainty, you should be able to calculate Y. So you should be able to go back and forth on this with complete ease. simple algebra. And these other situations, exponential logs, anti-logs, and so on, are given here. They're really actually special cases of all these things up here. So let's focus on these two for a second. Okay, so let's look at this example. Density is mass over volume. So we take a metallic object and we weigh it by difference in a graduated cylinder. So we put the chunk of metal down in the water. It weighs 2.503 grams. And we did this two or three times, and we got kind of a big uncertainty. 0.225 grams is our standard deviation. So we did this three times, that's our standard deviation. And then it displaced 0.130 mils. But you know, we're in a graduated cylinder, we're not too accurate on our volumes. Our uncertainty is 0.05 mils. So it's hard to read. So that's our uncertainty in volume. So you're looking at these uncertainties, it looks like the mass uncertainty is larger than the volume uncertainty. Okay. But we'll find out that may not be the right way to think about this. So here's the question, what's the density of this object? And can you tell if this is gold, which has a density of 19.28 grams per mil, or tungsten, 19.25 grams per mil? So the density is very easy. It's mass, net mass over net change in volume. So 2.503 divided by 0.130 mils, and this is our result that we get, 19.2538462 grams per mil. Okay. We're going to keep all these digits temporarily. If we had to round, where would we round in this situation?
2.5.
Yeah, so we would round here. 19. See, it's 2.5, so we would round. See, these are three significant figures here, so we'd round to 19.3.
Which still be gold or tungsten?
Yeah, it'd be closer to gold. Now, if we keep all these digits, we see it's 0.25, so it's really close to tungsten. So, which do you think it is? If we round up, it's gold. If we don't, it's tungsten.
But there's uncertainty in both.
Yeah, there's uncertainty in the numerator, and there's uncertainty in the denominator. Okay.
So there's more.
And so what do we do? We need to figure out this issue. Right at this point, we can't really tell the difference between the two. Okay. And so let's propagate this uncertainty for this calculation. So we want to calculate the standard deviation for our number, and we want to round to the correct place. Notice if knowing where to round here is just based upon the significant figure convention, right? What is the significant figure convention telling us about these two numbers? What is the significant figure convention telling me is the uncertainty of 0.130? Where's the uncertainty? Where's the uncertain digit?
Zero.
It's this one, it's the last digit. And how big is it? Plus or minus one in the last digit. That's the significant figure convention. But where is the uncertainty?
It's 0.05. Oh, it's the second one.
You see that? And the uncertain digit is actually here. And that's why I was saying the significant figure convention is bad, because it's not conservative enough. It's not bad enough. Okay? It would accidentally match if up here our uncertainty was 0.001. Okay, that would be an accidental or coincidental thing that it actually matched the significant figure convention. Okay, but we're not just given this number, we're actually given an estimate of the uncertainty here. And what about this one? Where's the uncertainty in this one? The significant figure convention says it's plus or minus one in the last digit, that this would be the uncertain digit, and it could be 0.2504 or 2502. That's what the uncertainty would be in the significant figure convention. But where's the uncertainty here? It's 0.2, so it's in the tenths place. You see that? So that's a real problem for our calculation. So rounding to 19.3 may not even be justified. Okay. So where do we round this number? We don't know where to round until we propagate the uncertainty. And so we set up this situation. This is multiplication and division, and so we're going to use this equation here. See that? So this is the equation we're using because it's products and quotients. It's mass over volume. Straightforward, right? You're able to categorize it. It's a multiplication division problem. So we need to use this equation here. And so I've written out the parts here. I've got the uncertainty in density. Density is the term for, it's rho is the symbol for density. So what's the uncertainty here? It's the density result that we have, 19.2538462. That's the y value in the previous slide. Okay. And it's times the square root of the RSDs squared. So where do we get the RSDs? It's the two components. One is the mass and one is the volume. Okay. So this is the mass component. That's the relative standard deviation for the mass. Straightforward. Okay, it's the 0.225 uncertainty on top and the mass value on bottom, 2.503. Notice the units cancel. Okay.
It's all numbers.
Yeah, so we're just comparing percentages here, or decimal percentages, right? So the grams are gone, and that's how we compare grams and mils. We got to take a ratio to get rid of the units. So the grams are gone. We take that value and we square it. Don't forget to square it. That's a common mistake. And then here's the volume one. 0.05 mils divided by 0.13 mils. The mils cancel, so we can now compare decimal ratios easily. And you square that. Don't forget to square it. Then you add those squared values together. You take the square root. And you multiply by the y value, and you get your uncertainty, 7.6 grams per mil. Okay, that's crappy, isn't it?
That's huge.
So that's telling us where to round. It's telling us we're uncertain in the ones place. So it's 19.3 plus or minus 7.6. Yeah, it's really bad.
So messed up.
Like, so can
you
yeah,
it is. So. And in fact, a lot of times people will say only keep one uncertain value, not two. I've seen both. The real key is these have to match. If I keep out to tenths place here, then I got to keep it to tenths place here. So if I keep two digits of uncertainty, then this tells me where to round. I have to round in the tenths place. If I wanted to keep one digit of uncertainty, I would say it's 19 plus or minus 7 grams per mil. Yes? Exactly. Yeah, it's very similar kind of thinking.
Mm-hmm. But don't you report like the certainty in court? Like, I don't think you say that in certainty.
Well, it's the same thing. How certain are you of 19? I'd say, it's plus or minus 7. Yeah.
Usually it's percentage too, right?
Well, take this and divide by that, and you get the RSD.
Okay.
So what's 7 over 19?
About a third, so you're about like 30%.
Yeah, so you're...
So they probably don't take that again.
You're only 70% certain, right?
Yeah.
Okay, not so good.
Okay. Closer to 60, I think.
Yeah, right. So that's how we would report this value, because our instrumentation is kind of bad. Now, this is an interesting point here. When you write this part of the equation out, you can kind of see which piece is giving you the trouble. So look at these fractions. Which fraction is larger? See, this is 5 divided by 13. You see how I can do that? I can just look at this and move the decimal place over. That's 5 divided by 13. And this is 2 divided by 25. Yeah, so 2/25 is a lot smaller than 5/13. So volume is our problem. We got to get a better way to measure volume. Because that's the biggest fraction in our uncertainty. This uncertainty analysis is a really big skill. Okay, it's not just plug and chug, get the value here. But when you want to think about how to improve the situation, how do I get a better measurement of density, if this is the data that I've got, I can look at this and say, wow, my uncertainty really came from the volume measurement. So if I could improve my volume measurement, I could improve my density measurements. So this biggest RSD is the one that's governing our problems, giving us problems. Okay. Let's look at that in terms of bar charts. Okay, so here's the mass. It's got a really narrow, essentially this 0.2, over 2.5 is 0.09, that's that ratio, so that's the width of our uncertainty in mass. But then 5 over 13 is 0.38. And so that's a really fat curve. And so if I take this fat curve, squared, if you will, add it to this fat curve, skinny curve squared, I end up with a fat curve in terms of density. So the width of my curve, this sort of, if I measure this over and over and over again, my data is going to fall in this bell curve. This bell curve is fat, meaning I'm uncertain because my volume measurement has a fat curve.
Was that like sigma is equal to like 4 times, wait, no. 4 sigma is equal to...
Yeah, we'll talk about that.
Okay.
And so this is just showing you those two fractions. And so let's take now our curve, our bell curve, if we were to do this density measurement over and over again, and compare it to the densities of all kinds of metals, not just tungsten and lead, or tungsten and gold.
Cool.
Yeah. And so here we have tungsten and gold, which were very close to our result. But if our bell curve is represented by the uncertainty in volume and the uncertainty in mass for our experiment, okay, then look how many metals would be contained just with this 50% confidence. Okay. So it's about a 50-50 shot that I have tungsten, gold, iridium, tantalum,
berkelium,
or lead, silver, thallium,
titanium,
you know. And so I really don't know much at all what I have. If I wanted to be 95% confident, then I want to get 95% of the area under my bell curve. And look how many metals that contains. It contains all of these metals. So I could say, well, I'm 95% confident it's not one of these. Okay? And that's still a result. Right? Magnesium's over here. And so I could say I'm 95% confident it's not magnesium. But if you want me to tell you what it is, I really don't know. It could be silver, it could be lead, it could be, you know, bismuth. But I can tell you, I'm 95% sure it's not magnesium.
That's even worse to say, like, if you're a doctor.
Yeah,
you're
exactly.
Buy something, you're
but
like,
we do this all the time, you know. Well, I know you don't have appendicitis. Because it's a headache. Right? But I can't tell if it's cancer or, you know, stress. So these are the metals contained in the 50-50 thing. So it could be one of these or it could not be one of those. So 50-50. Here's all the ones. I'm 95% sure it's in this list.
That's
horrible. Right? But magnesium's not in this list. So if magnesium was the thing that we're sure of, you know, we're interested in, then we may be okay. All right.
Could be antimony.
But it'd be you know, so it's not always, you know, a disaster. You've got a really uncertain measurement, but you do the statistics and you say, well, there's less than a 5% chance. That it's
magnesium. It's less than a 5% chance
you
have cancer.
Yeah, right, exactly. You know, but that's kind of crazy. So what this tells us, not so much about what metal it is, it tells us our procedure is pretty crummy. You know, we need to get a better volume measurement in particular. And then we could narrow our uncertainty curve, and we could be more certain about some metals, and then we could exclude too. So when I talked about inclusive and exclusive results, this is what we're talking about. So these are included by the statistics, and these over here are excluded. And sometimes that's enough. We don't have to have perfect procedures, but within our procedures, can we exclude and can we include, right? And so if magnesium was the thing that we were interested in, we can say with 95% confidence, this is not magnesium. So that may be enough. Do we know what it is? No. Do we have to know what it is? As a forensic scientist, sometimes you don't. You don't have to know what it is, but you set up your procedure and say, well, we can include this group and exclude that group.
It's not this.
And it's not magnesium. So if magnesium was the issue, then you can be confident. 95% confident it's not magnesium. So that's pretty cool. Even with a crummy procedure, we're able to exclude some things and include a whole lot more. So, yeah, but, right? Yeah, but the math worked out. The number was closest to tungsten. you got to take into account the uncertainty. You can't just take the mean value and say, well, it's so close. You really don't know that it's that close. You got lucky. It just matched that number really well. Okay, but you really, you're plus or minus 7 grams per mil. You really don't know. So this is how we miss planets. You know, they added in the unit conversion twice on one of the probes they sent to Mars and bounced it off the atmosphere. So you got to pay attention to the details. 2 years ago, a Minnesota bridge failed unexpectedly during, you know, rush hour, and again, measuring the corrosion and so on of the bridge girders, that did, you know, it just you got to pay attention to the details. So this is how these random errors occur. Again, these little fluctuations. You've got a true value which you really can't know, because there's really no way to actually measure the exact density of this substance. You've got volume measurement, you've got a mass measurement, both of those have some uncertainty in it. You know, maybe you've got a little bit of smudge on the inside of the glassware, so that throws off your volume measurement. Maybe you touched the metal with your fingers and now it's got grease on it. And so you've got all these tiny little fluctuations that spread out your data from measurement to measurement to measurement. And eventually you get this bell curve. After an infinite random number of fluctuations, you get a Gaussian distribution where some of the data has been skewed low and some of it's been skewed high, and you get this nice normal distribution. Okay? And so what we're saying with the confidence interval is that we're saying with this bell curve, I'm going to draw some limits on here, and those limits, I'm saying I'm 95% confident that it contains the original true value without smudges, without fingerprints, without anything like that.
It's like a...
Yeah, so you're trying to bracket your data and say, will I get that true value that I can't really measure? That's what the confidence interval is. And you're saying, I want to give you some limits that I say, well, here's my mean, this is the average value, plus or minus an interval that contains the true value. And so we use areas under the curve to get those statistics. So if I use plus or minus 1 sigma, which is common, you just report your data, here's the mean, and here's the sigma, plus or minus 1 sigma, that contains 0.683, so 68.3% of the area. So that would be a 68.3% confidence interval, plus or minus 1 sigma. Still not really great, because you're only covering 68% of that bell curve. Okay. You've got half of that on the low side, half of that on the high side. If you go plus or minus 2 sigma, then you're covering 95.4. So that's not bad. 95.4 is a plus or minus 2 sigma. And so you have, you know, 4.3% on this side and 4.3% on that side. Half of what's missing is on the high and half of what's missing is on the low. Okay? I think I did that wrong, 2.3. And so if we wanted exactly 95% confidence, it's not plus or minus 2, it's plus or minus 1.96. Okay. So if you wanted exactly 95%, you could report it plus or minus 1.96 sigma. And that gives you 95% of the area under this bell curve. And so you have 2.5% that might be low, or 2.5% chance that it's higher than that. So you're giving an interval where you think the true value is. And that's why we say a wider interval is a more conservative estimate. Because you're saying I'm 95% sure it's between these really big limits. If you give a narrower view, you're only 68% sure.
So that's like saying I'm 95% sure I can produce the
block. Yeah, whatever you're trying to measure, you know, again, you can't measure the true value. But you can measure multiple times, and you say, well, the central tendency is right here. Mm-hmm. Every time I measure it, I get close to this middle point. And so I'm going to average my data, I'm going to take the standard deviation, and then I'm going to report plus or minus 1.96 of that standard deviation, and that's the 95% confidence limits. Well, you know, this is essentially the same thing I've been saying in text. There's still a 5% chance that the true value is outside those limits. So let's say we measured this and we got this central tendency and we went plus or minus 1.96, and this was our range, one out of 20 times, our true value may be outside that range. Because, you know, five nickels and a dollar, right? Plus or minus, if you've got 5% that you're uncertain, that's one out of 20 times will it be outside. Now, that may not be good enough for you, okay? Let's look at this. 99% confidence can stink, okay? 20,000 lost articles of mail per hour. Wait a second, what? Unsafe drinking water 15 minutes per day. So, 5,000 incorrect surgeries a week. So this is, you're operating at 99% confidence, you know, two long or short landings at most major airports a day, or 200,000 incorrectly filled prescriptions a year.
Oh, that's bad.
Yeah, so this is not so great. 7 hours a month with no electricity. We pretty much had that in West Ridge. Not good, but the trees used to
be. The unsafe drinking water is very concerning.
Yeah, I know. Oh, or 16,204 murders in the U.S., 99% confidence would yield 162 wrongful convictions. Yeah, that's not cool, is it? So how do we get past this? Well, 99% confidence isn't good enough. Another way to say that is one measurement's not good enough. GC by itself is not good enough. So we couple GC and we operated, let's say, at 99% confidence, and we do FTIR and operate that at 99% confidence. And these two methods are not related to each other. And so it's very improbable that something would miss the GC and miss the IR. Right? So we have these overlapping confidences. And so it would be a 1% chance times a 1% chance. So 1 in 1,000 for something to fool or get past the GC and the IR. Right? So we do multiple measurements so that we have 1% chance times 1% chance times 1% chance. In other words, the way to get through all of these instruments is to be high by 3 sigma and then low by 3 sigma on this instrument and then high by 3 sigma on that instrument. Then, you know, pretty soon you're 99.9999% confident. And then we're getting down to numbers that we're comfortable with. Okay. In industry, we want to try for 6 sigma. And you'll see this movement in the crime labs of trying to operate at 6 sigmas away from a wrongful conviction, 6 sigmas away from unsafe drinking water, okay, or in firearms or in, you know, explosives analysis, 6 sigmas away from an unexpected detonation, right? So we want to operate with that. That's a 6 sigma is 4.3 defects per million opportunities. It's not zero, but, you know, what are you going to do? You can't have zero. You can't be 100% confident, but you can be close. I mean, 99.9999999996, because it's 4.3 per million opportunities. So we would like to operate that way. And so there's all kinds of agencies out there to train and quality control and so on to teach you how to increase the quality of your lab procedures and your analyses. Now, this is typically in business, they have an upper specification limit and a lower specification limit, and they want to operate, they want the mean to be more than 6 sigmas away from the acceptability limits. Now, in the crime lab situation, this would be, say, you know, a missed result, a false positive or a false negative. And so we'll do this. We'll look at some of these terms when we get into a nice little exercise in Excel. So what if these limits are really, really close to each other? Right? What if we're measuring bolt length or something like that, and you wanted your bolts to be 3 centimeters long, and it can't be 2.9 centimeters or 3.1 centimeters. So we're talking about only 2 millimeters difference. That's kind of a small spec, right? So in between these limits is 2 millimeters. How do you get 6 sigma away from that? Your production needs to be very narrow. Your uncertainty needs to be your volts need to come out at 3.001 or 2.999. And then you're 6 sigma away from being too long and 6 sigma away from being too short. That's difficult to do, but that's the goal. Okay. Same thing for your explosives analysis or drug analysis. You want to be so far away from, if it's cocaine, from saying it's not. Okay, and what peaks and values are you looking at to tell you it's this substance versus that substance, or it's this substance or not? And so you want to get as far away from those limits as possible, which means you have to have very repeatable procedures. So let's go back a little bit to this table here. And this is how we come up with those confidence limits. If for a sample, let's say you're doing titrations or the density example, we measure the density 3 times, and we want to come up with that uncertainty value. We have the mean value, which was that 19.3, and then we had the sigma value, which was 7.6, and we want to write the confidence interval. Okay. Let's say we only made 3 measurements. So what I showed you was our uncertainty, and it was just plus or minus 1 sigma. Let's come up with the real confidence interval. So if we use the 7.6, that was just plus or minus 1 sigma, okay? If we measured this 3 times, and that was our number of measurements, let's now come up with the confidence interval using the sample example, okay? So what do we need to do for this? We need to have this T value from our T chart, and we need the square root of N here. Now we did 3 measurements. What's our degree of freedom after calculating the mean?
2.
It's N minus 1. And so up here we have the degrees of freedom. Let's see. They're not showing. So it's degree of freedom 1, 2, and 3. That's not showing. Oh no, here it is. Confidence. N equals 1, 3, 5. So here's the column for 3. That would be the degrees of freedom of 2. We're going to come down to 95% confidence. So this is our T value used to compute our confidence interval. You see right there? That's this right here. So 3.182. So that's the T value for N minus 1 equals 2. That's typically how it's written in the tables. Okay. Times 7.6 grams per mil. Divided by the square root of 3.
1.8-ish. So the back part is 13.962. Sorry, all that is 13.96.
This is 13?
All, everything.
All of this. Okay.
13.9621. Sorry.
Okay. Saying. And so I went ahead. Now look where our uncertainty is for 95% confidence. You know, I drew that big bar there and I said, this is our 95% confidence range. This is how I got that number. Okay. And so how do you report this? Well, this tells you where to round, okay? You can report it one of two ways. You can do 19 plus or minus 14 grams per mil.
13.962, right?
Yeah. You can report it this way with 2 digits of uncertainty or 20 plus or minus 10. Yeah, it's huge. It's a crummy technique. Because our volume measurement is crummy. Our volume measurement is 38% uncertain. You know, our relative standard deviation for volume is 0.38. So our coefficient of variation is 38% in volume. So we really aren't very confident in the volume. So this is what we would report. But it, once again, it's not magnesium.
Definitely.
So this is, okay, so you can say at 95%. So you report your reported value and you give your confidence there, and you could say n equals 3. So this is the best way to report data, is you give your confidence interval, you tell people what confidence you used for that interval, and it's also courteous to tell them how many measurements you made.
The amount is very important, though, wouldn't it?
What?
The amount of measurements is really important, though, I thought.
Like, it is. But you can see now when you do the practice tests that there's all kinds of little numbers and number problems that ask you how to report data. You know, and it's not just rounding. It's also making sure that the rounding in the number matches the rounding in the uncertainty, right? You would not report it this way. Bad. Okay, 19.3 plus or minus 10. Why am I carrying this out to three decimal places when I only have one significant figure here?
Yeah.
You wouldn't write out 20 plus or minus 13.9. So once again, why am I reporting three uncertain digits here, you know, out to decimal places and not here? These have to match. Okay? You wouldn't write 19 plus or minus 13.9. Again, they don't match. You also wouldn't write 19.3 plus or minus 13.9. I've not seen examples where people are reporting three decimal place or three significant figures in their uncertainty. But I do see commonly two significant figures in uncertainty. Okay. Notice how this was rounded down when we went to one uncertain digit. And so that's, you're missing a little bit. But even then, how sure am I on this 4? Not very. If I'm unsure in tens, how can I be sure in ones? Okay. If I'm unsure in tens, very unsure in ones, I know nothing at all about the tenths place. Okay. So I've seen both of these, and so I would accept both of these, but I would not accept that. Okay. So three decimal place or three significant figures in uncertainty, I would count that wrong. Okay. Any kind of mismatch in the place value? Do you remember that term from K through 12? Place value, tenths, ones, tens. Okay, any mismatch in place value is also incorrect. Okay. So the place value has to match no more than two digits in your uncertainty. With that, let's do some more examples of propagating uncertainties. So let's do a calibration example. We will do some of this in Excel, but let's do an example by hand today. This is a bit good for work. So let's say we have this calibration chart. So we've measured various concentrations, we've prepared solutions of certain concentrations, and we've prepared this spectrometer, we've measured the absorbance, we've come up with this particular calibration curve. Now it's not perfect, right? You can look at the data and see, okay, this is maybe a few problems with this. What does that do in terms of our certainty of that line, right? When the line might, should probably maybe go closer to that point, but then it's further from that one. What if it went through that point? Then it's further from this one. So there's some uncertainty as to the slope of this line. Okay. If I change the slope of that line, guess what? I'm also changing the intercept. And so there's uncertainty in B and there's uncertainty in M. And a lot of times you can see, if you have a statistical package, it will plot the uncertainty curves along with your line. And that's pretty nice when you see that. Okay. So this is sort of the band of uncertainty. It gets bigger down here because I'm way outside my data range. It gets bigger up here because I'm outside of the data range. But I'm pretty confident here in the middle that a signal here corresponds to a concentration here. But I think it's useful to look at this band and see what's going on. If I measure an absorbance value and I want to calculate the concentration, this value comes across here and hits these three lines like this. And so here's the concentration I calculate, and here's my uncertainty. You see how that works? So visually, this is what we're doing. We're also going to include the uncertainty in our absorbance value. Okay. Because these also affect this uncertainty. So I have an uncertainty in my absorbance value. I have an uncertainty in my slope. I have an uncertainty in my intercept. And that all figures into the uncertainty in my concentration. It looks really complicated, but it's not. Okay? Because we have those calculations that we can do. We have the sum example, and we have the multiplication division example. And so we're going to use both of those in these calibration curves, because we have both involved. Let's take our equation here. I have my y value here equals mx plus b. We can say absorbance is equal to m times concentration plus b. And so if I measure an absorbance value for my unknown or for my evidence, then I've got to calculate the concentration. So let's solve for concentration. This is easy. I subtract b from both sides, and then I divide by n. So concentration is equal to absorbance minus b over n. So I have a numerator that is the addition-subtraction piece, and we'll have to calculate the uncertainty using the addition and subtraction propagation of uncertainty equation. And then I also have a division. And so then we'll have to use a different equation to calculate the uncertainty for the division piece. And so I will just call this top piece the numerator. And so we'll calculate the uncertainty in the numerator, and then we'll use that value and calculate the uncertainty in the fraction, and we get the uncertainty in the concentration. So let's put numbers on all of these things. So our absorbance value here is going to be 0.500, and the uncertainty in absorbance. It's not so good. It's 10%. Mm-hmm. Do them all at 10% so we can see what the final result will be. Okay. So then our value here, y equals mx plus b,
and is that the instrument's uncertainty, or how would you find that?
Let's say I measured the absorbance for this thing three times.
Okay.
And calculated the standard deviation. And so it's three absorbance measurements, and I got, that once I did the standard deviation, it was 0.05.
Okay.
Is that good? And so then but that's a great question. So now I'm going to get M and B. Where do those uncertainties come from? They come from my ANOVA table, from Excel. You know, you do you could do the trend line in the graph, and it'll give you M and B. But the trend line doesn't give you the uncertainty in M, or the uncertainty in B, the standard errors. So you have to do a linear regression. So remember that from Pecan. That's why we beat that drum. It doesn't just, it's not just about peak picking. It's about using the statistical tools that are available in Excel. So you would do a linear regression of all your concentrations would be your X input, and all your absorbance values would be your Y input. So you do a linear regression with that, and you get the intercept, and you get the value, which is B, and it's standard error. And then you get the slope, or X variable 1, they call it, and you get that, and it's standard error. Okay, so 10% error on this one as well, and B is equal to 0.200, and sigma B is equal to 0.02.
When do you get a cleaner blank?
Yeah, exactly. Sometimes they are offset. Yeah. So this is all of the values. We got this from a linear regression. ANOVA. Just for review, what does ANOVA stand for? Don't remember? Analysis of variance. Okay. Yeah, so the variance in the data, it's an analysis of variance. So the ANOVA table is just analyzing the variance in the data, and you get the values for M and B. So now we can calculate what our concentration would be. Because we have M and B and so on. So this is pretty easy.
1.5?
So, concentration is equal to 0.5 minus B, 0.2 over 0.1.
Oh, whoops. 3.
Okay.
Just 3.
So that's... 0.5 minus 0.2 is 0.3, divided by 0.1, so it's 3.
Sure.
3. Okay. So I'm going to end up with, it'll be 0.300 divided by 0.100. So again, I have 3 significant figures. I'm going to write this out as 3.00, but I want to know where to round. So. So where do I round this number? What's my uncertainty in this number? We don't know until we do the calculation, right? That's the point of this, is how certain am I in the concentration? Well, I've got uncertainty in my M, uncertainty in my B, uncertainty in my absorbance value. We've got to propagate this through. So we know where to round our concentration. We know what to report. We know how to calculate the 95% confidence interval. Okay. This is going to be a two-part computation. We can't do the fraction until we do this difference. So we're going to do the numerator. We're going to calculate the uncertainty in the numerator. Okay. So the numerator is equal to 0.5 minus 0.2. So 0.300, I'm going to keep a few of those guard digits. At a sigma numerator, we now have to do the square root of what? What numbers
0.0.
We calculate here? Go back in your notes and look at addition and subtraction.
It's the 0. 0.
So here are the pieces in my numerator. Let's go back here. It's going to be sigma for the absorbance squared
plus
sigma for the B value squared plus. We're adding up the variances. This minus sign just tells you it's addition and subtraction. Okay? So we add those, we square them and add them together. So we square the uncertainty in our absorbance and we square the uncertainty in our B, add them together and take the square root. So the absorbance was 0.05. And the B was 0.02. So this is the uncertainty in our numerator.
So 0.25 and 0.04. So 0.29.
Okay. What are you saying now? We got to move the decimal places too. So someone do this for me.
Should we have a 0.6708?
Did you do this? Oh, you did the square root. Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead and do the whole thing. Yeah. What is this again?
0.6708.
I'm going to keep all those digits. I'm not going to round anything until the end, okay? So 0.6708. Okay, now what is the unit on this one? Just to follow.
I put in a tensor plate.
Me too. So yeah, it's a 0.05385.
0.538. That'll be good enough, I think. Now what are the units on this? Let's go ahead and make our concentration units. We'll just call this.
Wait a second.
We'll just call our concentration ppm. Okay. What are the units on m? M is absorbance per ppm, right? It's the slope, rise over run. Okay? ABS per ppm. Okay? What is the units on B? What is B?
Absorbance.
B is our intercept, the y-intercepts, the y-values is absorbance. Okay? I'm just walking you through the units to show that they do work out. Okay? So this is in absorbance. Squared, absorbance squared, but then we take the square root, and so this ends up being absorbance. Just walking you through the units to show you that the units worked out as well. Okay. Now we know the numerator, and we know the uncertainty in the numerator. And so now we can calculate the uncertainty for the fraction. Okay, we can take this piece, and find out the uncertainty in our y value. So. Concentration, the uncertainty in our concentration. Our concentration was equal to 3.00 ppm. And our sigma concentration is equal to 3.00 ppm times the square root. So you can go back to that formula page. Make sure you understand how I'm putting all this together. I have some things squared. What are those things? So looking at our calculation, M is one of them. So I have M here and sigma M there. And I have numerator here and sigma numerator. This is the value that trips people up. Because you want to put B, or you want to put absorbance, but it's not, it's the numerator. Because it's the numerator divided by M. So the numerator ended up being 0.300 absorbance units. And so this is, I'll just go ahead and write it out. M value was 0.1. Uncertainty was 0.01. The numerator was 0.3. My uncertainty was 0.0538. Absorbance. This was ppm per absorbance.
Opposite.
Yes. It's, you see, it's almost irrelevant because they cancel, but I wanted to write it anyway. So the units cancel out. I get unitless, unitless, square those, take the square root, and look how the units then become ppm because I'm multiplying by the y value. And so my uncertainty is in ppm. So here we have 0.01 divided by 0.1, or 0.1, and 0.1 squared, 0.01. And then over here, a little more complicated calculation. So
we,
so
get,
we punch these through. Please.
Everything altogether is 0.61599.
The whole
everything,
thing?
Yeah.
With
okay.
the square root and times the third. Mm-hmm.
So say it one more time.
0.61599.
Okay.
Tricky one, or?
PPM. Okay, so that's our uncertainty from this measurement. And so now we can report our value, our concentration is equal to 3.0 plus or minus 0.6. Or we could write 3.00 plus or minus 0.62. But we wouldn't go any further than that. Now this is plus or minus 1 sigma. Okay, which is not really a good confidence interval, right? Because that's only 68% confident. And so let's now, we've used an ANOVA, so we know what the we know that these sigmas are here. Okay, so we can actually calculate the sigma for our uncertainty. It's as if we have a population now because we've done this regression analysis. And so we can use this as an ANOVA. I know it's hard to see, but it's plus or minus Z sigma. And so there's a Z column on here for a population, and that's that 1.96. So for 95% confidence, we just multiply that 0.61 by 1.96. So our concentration reported value?
3 plus or minus 1.2.
3 point what?
1.2 is the...
1.2, okay. 3.0 plus or minus 1.2 ppm at 95% confidence.
Could you just times it?
Notice I didn't do the t-table. I didn't do the degrees of freedom or anything like that. Because I have a calibration curve, I know what my population sigma is. We calculated it using our ANOVA output. And so I can just take that value and use Z instead of T. Z is for a population, and so I can use 1.96. And I don't have to worry about the T table, I don't have to worry about dividing by the square root of N and all of that.
Okay. Easy.
So this is our reported value for this analysis, and you see the propagation of uncertainty is not that difficult. We did it all by hand here. You could put these formulas in Excel as well. Okay. In fact, I asked you to do it last semester in all your labs. You know, some few of you did 2 years ago, whenever you took it. Okay, but it's time to do it. Okay.
That's still a good 2/5.
Yeah.
In your number.
What's the question? I'm sure it's a good one.
I understand where you got the ones that you choose.
Okay. Yeah. This. Yeah. So it's. This piece right here, it's a good question, is 1.96 sigma CONC. So that's the Z value for 95% confidence is 1.96, and you multiply that by this value here, 0.6159.
And that's 3 sigma?
That's what?
That's 3 sigma instead of 1 sigma?
No, that's
95%.
It's not 1.96 sigma, actually.
Oh, okay.
It's almost 2.
Almost 2 sigma.
And the reason it's not 2 is because 2 captures 95.4% of the area. So plus or minus 2 sigma is 95.4%
exactly.
confidence. And so that's a little cumbersome to say. So we just say 95% confidence, which means we bring it in a little bit. It's not plus or minus 2 sigma, it's 1.96. It's almost 2.
Okay.
If we wanted 99% confidence, we would multiply by 2.576. So plus or minus 2.576 would give us 99% confidence.
And you get that from a Z chart?
A Z chart. And I've got one that goes up to 99.99 in the notes. Yeah, and I've put down at the bottom in that table how you calculate those with Excel. So there's a norm inverse and the parentheses, 0.05 and all this stuff. The formula's in there, so you can calculate what those Z values would be in Excel. And you could report 99.999 if you want. Okay? You just keep multiplying by more, multiplying your signals by a bigger and bigger number to capture 99.999% of the area under a normal Gaussian curve.
Very confident.
Yeah, you're very confident then, But what you've really done is told them it could be anything, right?
It's infinity.
But if your data is really very tight, then you could say, yeah, I'm 99.999% sure. And you only capture a few possibilities because you've got a really tight
calibration curve. Is
accepted
in court, is it
98? I don't know. That's where my lack of experience of, I just haven't been in a lot of court cases or seen a lot. But that would be a good question for like Dr. Kerrigan.
Right.
So I think probably 95% confidence is standard.
Yeah.
Because we overlap multiple techniques. And so each individual analysis is at 95% confidence. And so you'd have really 2.5% chance of being low below this one and 2.5% chance of being high on that one. So you're multiplying everything by 0.025 to get through all of those. And let's say you had three techniques. 0.025 times cubed would be your probability of getting through all three techniques. So that's pretty low. Okay, that's all we have for today. Thanks.